Hi and welcome to Med Simplified. In this video, we will discuss about glycolysis. I made a video on the topic of glycolysis a few years back and that was a very popular video among you guys. Since then, a lot of people have requested me for an update on that video. So I decided to make a new video on glycolysis which will be more detailed and elaborate. So I hope you like this video and as always, I am grateful for your generous support to this channel that we have grown so much in a matter of few years. You can now become a part of Med Simplified's community on patreon.com and get awesome benefits in return. Check out our community at patreon.com. Links are in the description below. So let's begin with glycolysis. And before beginning, I hope that all of you are familiar with the process of digestion of carbohydrates and how different enzymes in our gut act on complex carbohydrates like starch and convert it into simple sugars like glucose that are absorbed in the blood. Let's first start with an overview about this process of glycolysis. At the end of digestion of carbohydrates, we get simple monosaccharides like glucose, fructose, and galactose. Please note at this point of time, we have not extracted any energy from these sugars, and in fact use energy to digest and absorb them. These sugars then undergo glycolysis, which produces acetyl-CoA. A small amount of energy is also produced at this step. This acetyl-CoA is then used in another biochemical cycle known as the Krebs cycle or the citric acid cycle, which takes place inside the mitochondria of the cells. In this cycle, we extract almost all of the energy that is present in these sugars in the form of ATP, NADH, and FADH. ATPs are utilized directly for energy, whereas NADH and FADH are high energy molecules that are used in the next step, which is the electron transport chain, where the high energy electrons present in NADH and FADH are used to produce a lot more ATPs. You can check out the videos on Krebs cycle and electron transport chain on our channel to learn more details about them. In this video, we will look at the first phase of carbohydrate metabolism, that is glycolysis, in which glucose, galactose, and fructose are converted into pyruvate and then to acetyl-CoA through a series of 10 reactions, and how these reactions produce energy. Glycolysis takes place in almost every cell of the body. If you look at the term glycolysis, you can see that it is made up of two words, glyco and lysis. Glyco meaning glucose and lysis meaning breakdown. So glycolysis is a process in which we break down glucose. We begin with glucose and end with pyruvate or lactate, depending upon whether oxygen is available in the process or not. If oxygen is available, we call it aerobic glycolysis, and almost all of the glycolysis that takes place in humans is aerobic, except some situations in which anaerobic glycolysis takes place, which doesn't require oxygen. We'll discuss these situations a little bit later in this video. Now let's start with the actual process of glycolysis. So glucose is transported inside the cells by special protein channels in the membrane of these cells. These channels are of two types, the GLUT receptors and the SGLT transporters. There are different types of GLUT and SGLT channels which are present in different types of the cells in the body, and they behave differently, also because different types of cells have different requirements for glucose. So glucose is inside the cells. Now what next? Well, the next step is actually very simple and the first step of glycolysis. Glucose which has entered our cells can easily escape outside, and to prevent this, we attach a phosphate group to this glucose molecule to make this a glucose 6-phosphate, since a phosphate group is being attached to this glucose at the 6th carbon. This phosphate is provided by ATP and it gets converted to ADP. This makes the glucose molecule highly polar, and as you know, polar molecules cannot cross the cell membranes easily, so glucose gets trapped inside the cells. This step is irreversible and is performed by the enzyme hexokinase. Hexo means 6, meaning that these enzymes act on 6 carbon sugars like glucose and galactose, And kinases are basically those enzymes that transfer a phosphate group from a high energy molecule to another molecule, which in this case is a phosphate group that is being transferred from ATP to glucose. Now the enzyme hexokinase has four subtypes named 1 to 4, and the number 4 is known as glucokinase. Number 1 to 3 are found in most of the cells in our body, but the fourth type of hexokinase known as a glucokinase is specially located in the liver cells and the beta cells of pancreas. The fourth type of hexokinase is different from the rest three in a sense that it doesn't get saturated easily, meaning it can keep working even if there is a large concentration of glucose in the blood. This is important because large amounts of glucose is released from the gut after a meal that directly goes in the liver from the portal vein. Presence of such an enzyme that doesn't get saturated easily allows our liver to prevent excess glucose to enter our systemic blood circulation. In the pancreas, the glucokinase is a part of glucose sensing mechanism present in the beta cells of pancreas. Okay, so this was the first step in glycolysis, attaching a phosphate group to the glucose molecule and preventing its escape from the cells. This reaction was catalyzed by the enzyme hexokinase, and this reaction also uses one molecule of ATP that donates its phosphate group to the glucose. The next step is also very simple, in which an enzyme isomerase converts glucose 6-phosphate into its isomer fructose 6-phosphate. This isomerase is also known as glucose phosphate isomerase, which catalyzes this isomerization reaction, which could be reversed under normal cell conditions. After the formation of fructose 6-phosphate comes a very important step, in which additional phosphate group is attached to the fructose 6-phosphate, making it a fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Bis stands for 2, indicating that it has two phosphate groups now. This addition of another phosphate group is catalyzed by the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1. Again, kinases are those enzymes which transfer a phosphate group from one molecule to another, which in this case is a phosphate group being transferred from ATP to fructose 6-phosphate. The ATP is in turn converted to ADP. So note here that we are actually using energy in this reaction also. This reaction here is very important because of the following two reasons. This reaction is irreversible because it is energetically favorable in this direction only. It is also very important in the aspect that it helps in controlling the rate of glycolysis. When our energy stores are low, this increases the AMP levels in the cell. The raised AMP levels in the cell signal the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1 to increase the rate of reaction. And on the contrary, if energy stores are high, meaning we have lots of ATP in our cells, this conversely decreases the rate of reaction so that the reaction proceeds at the rate that is optimal. But there are many other factors that control the rate of this reaction. We will discuss more on the regulation of glycolysis at the end of this video. Now, most of you will be familiar with the ringed and the open structure of glucose. But for those of you who don't, here is an important side note. Up till now, I have denoted glucose with this. This is the ringed structure of glucose. The carbon atoms in this glucose molecule are numbered from 1 to 6, starting with carbon number 1, which is the carbon atom next to the functional group. Now, no need to go into the details of this, but if you open this ringed structure, you get the open chain form of glucose, which looks like this. Again, you can note the numbering on these carbon atoms. Now, for the sake of simplicity, we can just represent glucose by this linear structure, in which we omit the other groups like hydroxyl groups and hydrogen atoms. The carbon atoms in this linear structure will be numbered from 1 to 6 in the similar manner. This is just to simplify the concept of how phosphate groups are attached and removed as we progress through the pathway of glycolysis. Let's proceed further with glycolysis. So we have reached a point in glycolysis where glucose has entered the cell. We have attached one phosphate group to this glucose molecule at the 6th carbon, making it a glucose 6-phosphate. Then we converted it into an isomer known as fructose 6-phosphate. And after that, we have attached another phosphate group at the carbon number 1, making it a fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. This phase of glycolysis is known as the energy investment phase because up till now we have just used energy in the form of adding two ATPs, here and here. After this begins the energy generation phase, where we actually produce energy in glycolysis. This second stage of glycolysis begins with the splitting of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate. So a 6-carbon fructose is split into two molecules which have 3 carbons each. You can easily remember their names by the mnemonic GAP and DAP. Now this reaction is reversible and it is catalyzed by the enzyme aldolase. Since the reverse reaction of this step, that is the combination of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and dihydroxyacetone phosphate, is a type of aldol condensation, this enzyme is known as aldolase. These compounds are isomers and can be readily converted into each other by an isomerase known as triose phosphate isomerase. Again, triose meaning it can act on sugars with 3 carbons only, and isomerase since it is converting one isomer into another. This interconversion is important as only glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate can proceed further with the reactions of glycolysis. So dihydroxyacetone phosphate is isomerized into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is on a direct pathway in glycolysis. This isomerization results in the net production of two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate from the cleavage of one molecule of fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. The preceding steps in glycolysis have transformed one molecule of glucose into two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. We now come to a series of steps that harvests some of the energy contained in glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. For the next reaction of glycolysis, we have the enzyme dehydrogenase, also known as glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. And to understand this reaction, you have to dig a little bit deeper into its mechanism. Now, as you might know that dehydrogenases are enzymes that catalyze oxidation-reduction reactions, meaning these enzymes remove hydrogen, that is why dehydrogenase, and removal of hydrogen is known as oxidation. The hydrogen that they remove must be passed on to some other molecule, and that molecule gets reduced, and that is how the dehydrogenases catalyze the oxidation reduction reactions. In this reaction, the enzyme glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase acts on glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and removes the hydrogen atoms from the carbon number 1 and 2, which are then transferred to NAD to make the NADH. Since water is also involved in this reaction, an OH group gets attached to the carbon number 1. Now this intermediate has high free energy and it is very unstable. It loses its excess free energy and the phosphate group gets attached to this intermediate, making it a stabler bisphosphate known as 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Because two phosphate groups are attached to it, now the new one being at the first carbon. So this is how the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate gets converted to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. Now coming back to the main pathway of glycolysis, we started with glucose, a 6-carbon compound, which is then converted to glucose 6-phosphate, which after a few reactions is converted to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, still a 6-carbon compound. It is then cleaved into two molecules, which are 3-carbon compounds, GAP and DAP. Only GAP can proceed further with glycolysis, which is fine as the DAP can be easily isomerized to GAP by triose isomerase. So if you look at it carefully, we now have two molecules of GAP for every one molecule of glucose that we started with. GAP is acted upon by GAP dehydrogenase enzyme and converted into a bisphosphate, known as 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, which is a high energy molecule and is used in the next few reactions to derive some energy in the form of ATP. The conversion of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate uses a molecule of inorganic phosphate that is being attached to the carbon number 1. And this reaction is also very important in a sense that NAD is being converted to NADH. This NADH will be further used to make more ATPs in the electron transport chain. Now, since we have two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate for every one molecule of glucose that enters glycolysis, two NADs are actually being reduced here, which generate two NADH. And here you can see the second phosphate group that is being attached to the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to make it a bisphosphoglycerate. In the next reaction, the high energy phosphate group that is attached to the carbon number 1 is used to make ATP. The enzyme that acts on this reaction is known as phosphoglycerate kinase. And as you know, kinases are enzymes that transfer phosphate groups from one molecule to another. Here, the phosphate group at the first position in the 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate gets transferred to a molecule of ADP, converting it into an ATP. The 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is in turn converted to 3-phosphoglycerate, since the phosphate group at the first position is now lost. This is the first energy producing step that takes place in glycolysis, and it is also known as substrate level phosphorylation. See, basically we have two main ways to produce ATP in the body, through ionic gradients that happen in the electron transport chain in the mitochondria, or by using the energy that is present in the high energy bonds of different substrates, which is known as the substrate level phosphorylation. In the conversion of 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate to 3-phosphoglycerate, the high energy bond between the carbon number 1 and the phosphate group is broken, and that energy is used to convert ADP into an ATP, which is an example of substrate level phosphorylation. Here you should also note that 2 ATPs are produced per molecule of glucose in this reaction, since 1 molecule of glucose was split into 2 earlier in glycolysis. After this, we are left with 3-phosphoglycerate, which has only one high energy phosphate group attached now. In the next two steps of glycolysis, the 3-phosphoglycerate gets converted to 2-phosphoglycerate and then to phosphoenol pyruvate. This phosphoenol pyruvate then loses its high energy phosphate group, which is then used to make another ATP by attaching that phosphate group to ADP. This phosphoenol pyruvate then gets converted into pyruvate. The enzyme which converts 3-phosphoglycerate to 2-phosphoglycerate is a mutase, more particularly known as the phosphoglycerate mutase. And after that, we have the enzyme enolase that acts on 2-phosphoglycerate to convert it into phosphoenol pyruvate. After this step, the enzyme pyruvate kinase acts on phosphoenol pyruvate to convert it into pyruvate. The phosphate group on the phosphoenol pyruvate is removed and used to convert an ADP to ATP. In this step also, you can note that 2 ATPs are produced, as 1 glucose was earlier split into 2 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So we are basically done with the complex part of glycolytic pathway. Now you need to know just a few more things to understand glycolysis completely. So you need to know how fructose and galactose are used in this pathway. You also need to know how this pathway is regulated, meaning how hormones and other factors can increase or decrease the rate of glycolysis in different ways. How ATP is generated from NADH. And the last thing you need to know is the fate of pyruvate. So this is the summary reaction of glycolysis. Glucose plus 2 molecules of inorganic phosphate plus 2 NADs plus 2 ATPs give 2 molecules of pyruvate, 2 molecules of NADH, 2 hydrogen ions, 2 molecules of water, and 2 ATPs. Now, some of you may find this reaction easy to understand, but if you're like me and hate chemistry as much, let me decode this reaction for you. On the left hand side of this reaction is the input. You can take these things like the raw materials that we are using in glycolysis. We begin with 1 molecule of glucose, which gets split into 2 molecules of pyruvate. That is why the prefix 2 is attached to all other substrates used in this reaction. We use 2 inorganic phosphate molecules in this pathway. They are used in the step when glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is converted to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. You may be confused that only one phosphate is being used here, but please remember that we are essentially getting 2 molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate for every 1 molecule of glucose that enters the pathway of glycolysis. 2 NADs are used in this reaction, which accept hydrogen and get reduced to NADH, which is subsequently used in the electron transport chain to make more ATPs. 2 hydrogen ions are produced here in this oxidation-reduction reaction. 2 ADPs are converted to make 2 ATPs. These 2 molecules of water are produced in the dehydration reaction of 2-phosphoglycerate to phosphoenol pyruvate, and this gives us the final reaction of glycolysis. Now, if you look at how much energy is derived from glycolysis, you can first note that glycolysis consists of an energy expenditure phase and an energy producing phase. In the first phase, we use 2 ATPs. 1 ATP is used here to convert glucose into glucose 6-phosphate, and the next one is used here in the conversion of fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. So till now we are in a negative 2 balance for ATPs. In the energy generation phase, how much ATPs are produced actually depend upon whether oxygen is available or not. Let's first suppose oxygen is not available. In this case, there are only 2 sites of energy generation in this pathway. One site is here when 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate is converted to 3-phosphoglycerate, and one site is here when phosphoenol pyruvate is converted into pyruvate. Both these are examples of substrate level phosphorylation that we discussed earlier. Now, since we started with 1 molecule of glucose which was split into 2, the number of ATPs produced in this reaction are actually 4 ATPs per molecule of glucose. So if oxygen is not available, we use 2 ATPs here and produce 4 ATPs here. So net ATP gain is only 2 ATPs. Now what happens if oxygen is available in glycolysis? Oxygen has no direct role in this pathway of glycolysis, but has a very important role indirectly, and that is here in this reaction. Here, as you can remember, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is converted into 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. The enzyme making it possible is the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase, which removes hydrogen from glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate and attaches it to NAD to make it NADH. But the thing is that there is only an unlimited amount of NAD in the cell, so NADH has to be reconverted to NAD again. And this takes place in the electron transport chain present in the mitochondria of the cells. And this is exactly where oxygen plays a very important role. Electron transport chain keeps the supply of NAD in order and also produces 2.5 new ATPs in this reaction. This is an example of generation of ATPs through ionic gradients, and it is different from substrate level phosphorylation that we discussed earlier in this video. Now we are getting an additional 2 NADH molecules in aerobic glycolysis per molecule of glucose that enters the pathway. So a quick recap on the energetics of glycolysis. We are using 2 ATPs in the investment phase of glycolysis, and we are producing 4 ATPs in the payoff phase. That gives us a net gain of only 2 ATPs in the anaerobic glycolysis. In the aerobic glycolysis, we are getting an additional 2 NADH molecules that will be used in the electron transport chain to produce more energy. Okay, so this was about the energy generation in glycolysis. Now you also need to know how galactose and fructose enter this pathway. For fructose, it is simple. Most of the fructose that we consume goes into our liver and gets metabolized into fructose 1-phosphate, which through another intermediate enters the glycolysis here. Galactose is converted to glucose 1-phosphate through a series of 4 reactions. The glucose 1-phosphate is then converted into glucose 6-phosphate by a mutase, which enters the pathway of glycolysis here. Now let's understand how this pathway of glycolysis is regulated, meaning how is the rate of glycolysis increased or decreased when required. First, let's understand in brief why regulation of this pathway is required. Glycolysis is basically a type of pathway that lies in the center of many metabolic pathways like Krebs cycle, electron transport chain, nucleotide synthesis, lipid synthesis, etc. And it is also very important for the generation of energy. So as you can see that it is not a type of pathway that starts with glucose and we get the final product in the end which has no further use. Rather, it is a pathway in which different products are produced that are used elsewhere in the body. For example, glucose 6-phosphate is used to make building blocks of DNA, the nucleotides. Dihydroxyacetone phosphate is used to make glycerol, which is a very important substance for making essential lipids in our body. Pyruvate is important for production of cholesterol and fatty acids. And glycolysis is also very important for the generation of energy. So it becomes important to regulate this pathway at more than one point, which allows the regulation of several pathways to be coordinated. For example, dihydroxyacetone phosphate is used to make glycerol, which is used to synthesize important lipids and store energy. Now, when you are in a well-fed state, you have abundant energy in your body. Your pathway of glycolysis doesn't need to go till the end because you don't need more energy, but it still needs to go till dihydroxyacetone phosphate, which can be diverted to produce glycerol so that you can synthesize fat and store it for energy. Metabolic control must therefore allow glucose to be converted into dihydroxyacetone phosphate, even though the complete breakdown till pyruvate need not occur at such high rates. Now if you go into the details, this pathway is regulated at three main points by controlling the activity of three enzymes that act on these three points. At the first point, we have the hexokinase, and regulation at this step is simple. If the concentration of glucose 6-phosphate rises in the cell, the enzyme hexokinase is shut off, thus serving as an overall check on this pathway. The next point is here, the conversion of fructose 6-phosphate to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and the enzyme acting here was the phosphofructokinase. Now, phosphofructokinase is mainly regulated by three important factors: the energy content of the cell, hormones, insulin and glucagon, and the levels of citrate in the cell. We have discussed how the levels of ATP affect the function of phosphofructokinase earlier in this video. An increase in the level of ATP of the cell decreases the activity of the enzyme phosphofructokinase and thus decreasing the overall rate of glycolysis. Insulin increases this rate of reaction by increasing the activity of phosphofructokinase. Now, insulin is released when we have plenty of glucose in our blood. This glucose needs to be converted into pyruvate fast for energy production and generation of other intermediates. So insulin increases the rate of glycolysis, so excess glucose in the blood can be metabolized, and it does so by increasing the activity of the enzyme phosphofructokinase. Glucagon decreases the activity of the enzyme phosphofructokinase, thus allowing the blood glucose levels to increase. This hormonal regulation is indirectly done by means of fructose 2,6-bisphosphate. Citrate is a molecule that is an intermediate in the Krebs cycle. Now, pyruvate is further fed into the Krebs cycle. So, if the concentration of citrate rises in the cell, it becomes important to decrease this entry, which is done by decreasing the activity of phosphofructokinase by high levels of citrate. The third point of regulation of glycolysis is at the last step, that is the conversion of phosphoenol pyruvate to pyruvate by the enzyme pyruvate kinase. So the regulation at this step is very simple. You just have to remember that if the products of this pathway, ATP and acetyl-CoA, accumulate in excessive concentration in the cell, this inhibits the pathway of glycolysis at this step. This is also just a normal negative feedback mechanism that operates in many pathways in our body. So this was the regulation of glycolysis. Now we'll come to the last topic in the video, that is what happens to pyruvate next. See, the pyruvate has mainly three fates. First, it can be converted into acetyl-CoA, which is further used in the Krebs cycle. This is done by the enzyme pyruvate dehydrogenase. Second, pyruvate can be converted into oxaloacetate by the enzyme pyruvate carboxylase. Oxaloacetate can be used in the Krebs cycle or for gluconeogenesis. Thirdly, pyruvate can also be converted into ethanol by decarboxylation, but this occurs in yeast and not in humans. Guys, thank you so much for watching this video. If you found this video and all the other free educational videos on this channel helpful, you can now support Med Simplified on patreon.com for literally the price of a coffee cup. This will allow me to fund my work and make more videos like this, and will also unlock some cool Patreon only exclusive content like behind the scenes of these videos, upcoming videos, early notifications, and exclusive flashcards and handouts. Make sure to subscribe us on YouTube for all the upcoming videos, and also make sure to follow us on Instagram and Facebook for flashcards, notifications, and much more.